Next speaker. Before we start, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Ho Chi Kwan, Dean of Faculty of Computing and Informatics, FCI, Multimedia. Let me introduce him. Let's see his background. Okay. Dr. Chi Kwan Ho is a professor of computer science in the Faculty of Computing and Informatics, Multimedia University. He has been serving as the Dean of Faculty since 2008. He is a member of the National Big Data Analytical Task Force and the National ICT Talent Task Force. He has consulted for both public and private sector in the area of data analytical. Dr. Ho won the award for Outstanding Contribution to Education in 2015, Asia's Education Excellence Award. He has served on technical program committee of numerous international conferences related to big data. More recently, he has been a general co-chair for the Pacific Rim Conference on Multimedia 2014 and program co-chair for the Pacific Asia Conference on Knowledge Discovery and Data Mining 2012. He also organized the international workshop on learning semantic for international big data. So please help me welcome Professor Dr. Ho Chi Kwan.
Present some of the things that either myself or our team has done on a research basis or on a commercial project basis. And from there, actually, I will just try to point out some of the things that you can do as for research or where to look to. I think it's more interesting rather than giving a lecture, right? Okay, so the title is Data Science from the Frontline, so I'm just going to share some of the experience. In fact, right now we are in the middle of a commercial project. My team is actually doing the UAT right now in Putrajaya. And so I will share some of the things there. It's actually a commercial project, and we also have some research projects. So hoping that some of the real issues that we face in the when implementing projects can actually motivate you to turn into a research projects. Now, I'm not sure the audience here, whether most of you are in creating multimedia content or whatever. I'll try to adapt based on that. Okay, and I'll show some examples related to media, entertainment, and so on. Okay, and I'm going to have to go up and down because I'm going to show you some demo and so on. So they will not all be from the slides. I'm not going to attempt to define what is data science because different people have different ideas about it and so on. So don't bother, even though we have a data science specialization, a new specialization which is coming up, so a bit of advertisement. So what I try to do is I try to look at what is a widely accepted description, not definition, a widely accepted description of what people think data science is. And data science or big data or whatever is not something new. If you ask me, I think within 2 or 3 years' time, it's going to be business as usual. You're not going to hear about it, you know, much because it's going to be business as usual. Okay. So these are basically the three things, right? So if you look at the Venn diagram, just right here, so typically, I say typically, because there are always an exception. So the first thing is that you look at down here, which is basically business side. Because if you look at real project implementations, the first thing that people want to ask before they invest in such projects is what's the value to me, right? If it's not a project as a research project that we do in the university and so on, everything has to be driven by what is the business problem that you want to solve. Okay, so that is a number one thing, because that will actually get the buy-in from management and so on. So so some business acumen is necessary. You need to understand what is the key objective of doing the project or even doing the analysis. So more on that when I show you the example. The second one is actually some technology skills. You need to be able to use some tools, whatever that may be. If you, for those who are in computer science at least, you can program, but there are a lot of tools these days which you don't have to code at all. I will show some of them to you. And some mathematics is required. Some amount of mathematics is required. Of course, you can use some the tools as a black box, but at the end of the day, you need to interpret what comes out of it, and you need to understand how to tune it. So we may find out there business people, we can find people with some technology skills and so on. We can find people who are mathematicians or who are aware of some mathematics. But the reality is that in many projects, it's very difficult to find people who are at the intersection of all these three things. We can find, but it may not be easy. So in many situations, whether it's research or real projects, we usually look for two people. One group of people who are able to do at least the technology side and have a bit of idea about mathematics. And down here is actually the domain experts. Right? So the domain experts who are, example, if you are going to, let's say, predict flood, right? If you ask me to do it, I'm not a hydrological engineer. Right? I have no idea whatsoever about how the river runs and so on. Okay, so in such things, usually we have the engineers coming in. So it's actually a multidisciplinary. So to start off with, actually going in line with the theme of this symposium, I suppose that we are actually looking at across multidisciplinary sort of area. Okay, so if you have a bunch of data that you have, So how do you even start? Okay, so we ask the question: how does typical data analytics pipeline look like? So there are many of them. So here's one. This is not mine. I just did a quick Google search, and there are many of them. But typically, you get an idea where, first you gather the data first, you acquire data, whatever means you have, whether it is census data, or whether it is machine data, or sensor data, and so on. You then do model development, test the model, and then you deploy. So this is a standard cycle that we go through in project implementation. Now, I'm just going to, I just have very few slides, but what I want to do is that I want to go over to my notebook now and show you what we mean by some of these things. So the first screen that I'm going to show to you is actually a real project that we are doing now. Because of NDA, I can't tell you what exactly is the project. What I can tell you is that the project is actually on how to forecast our API, Air Pollutant Index. In Bahasa, it's called Index Pencemaran Udara, or Index Quality Udara, whatever. So let me go there. Masters, here is our database. Go in and take whatever that you need. Okay, so whatever you call yourself, data scientist or analyst or whatever, the first thing that you need to know is you need to know how to actually get the data out. Before, you may know how to get the data out, but what kind of data do you want to get out of it, and what is the architecture of the database? So that's the very first thing that we needed to do in the cycle, right? Okay. Because if I pass you a set of Excel files now, you know the problem, but you probably do not know what's inside. So the very first thing that we need to do is actually to understand what we have. So this is one of the free tools that you can use. It's called Trifecta. I'm not associated to any of the vendors, by the way. So obviously, because this is air quality, so we have so air quality in Malaysia is defined by five key components. One is actually the SO2, the sulfur, I think. The other one is NO2, O3 is ozone, CO is carbon monoxide, PM10 is your particulate matter 10. You can actually convert to PM2.5, there's a formula. And what we want to actually predict is actually this one, the main API. Now, anyone has any idea how to, based on these five components, how to calculate the API? Sometimes when you get a warning that, okay, school is closed tomorrow because the API is bad. So it turns out that it's actually quite simple. If you go and look into the protocol, how to decide this, what it says is look at the five values and take the maximum. So that will give you actually the API quality. Whether it's good or bad, is you can make comment on it later during lunch. So the API, the number that you see is the maximum of any of these five values. So so the job is actually how to predict that API value. Okay. So the very first thing is that once we extract the data, also here comes the pipeline, right? So you can use this for any data, whether it's media data, entertainment data, and so on. So basically, first you look at whether data is good or is it dirty, or you know they're missing values and so on. So I just click on the first one, which is just SO2, and you can see over here that there are about 11,000 valid values. There are about 424 missing values and so on. And there are 148 outliers, so-called. And you can also see that the distribution of the values here for this particular variable. So actually, you have quite a number of outliers which are quite large, so that might pose a problem to the job later on. So as part of the first step that usually we do is actually to just look into what is going on inside the data. Okay, this is actually quite clean up. In the real world, the data that you get firsthand is actually very dirty, many missing values. So you probably need to do some cleaning before you would come to before you arrive at this one. Okay, so this is the very first thing that you do. You don't do things. Yeah.
Is it all right to?
Just
curious. You start for the values there. This come in form of time series and also by geographical location.
Yes, exactly. So this is only for one station. I'm showing only for one station.
So it's a time series.
Yes. So it's actually a time series essentially across time and across space. So it's so if you look at multiple stations, then it becomes a spatial temporal. So this is just the data for one station for the five things, five values. Okay. So that would be the first part of it, the data gathering and also processing. Now, what are some of the key challenges? Now, most of the time when you are involved in certain projects, the data don't belong to you, right? So almost, the struggle is actually getting the data in. So that is the number one key struggle. I'm not sure. Of course, if you look at standard open data set, it's there. But if you work on certain other problems, then the data is not readily available. You probably have to go through some process of approval. If you are working, for example, with medical data and so on, I just met one professor yesterday who worked with medical data in Germany. Mm-hmm. The ethics committee takes 2 years to actually approve the release of data. So your project, the first 2 years is spent doing that. So these are some of the key things that we want to look at. Now, the next one, I'm going to go very quickly, and some of the demos here, I just do it crudely, 10 minutes and so on, with no refinement and so on, but just to show you what can be done. So once you have your data, everything inside, so that is that you need to do the model development. Usually we work with number of tools. So I just did this before I come here, otherwise I have nothing to show you. I just did this during another talk. So actually very quickly, so this is a very crude way of looking at things. So this is actually the first variable system, SO2. I think what Dr. Ng mentioned is here, a time series. So this is the series plot of the entire, this is for the past, for the last, this is data for the month of August. This is for the past, I think, five. The interval is actually 1 hour, so they measure actually one hour. So this is looking at the past, maybe for 500, and then predicting forward. So in this case, this is just a time series model. It's auto-aggressive, integrated moving average. So the shaded portion on the right-hand side there is actually the predicted part with the confidence interval. That means the further we predict to the future. the band will become fatter. That means you are more uncertain. So these are some of the. But what this is the objective is actually to narrow down the band. Okay, so that is the work of model building and so on. Right. So this is another thing that you can do. Okay. Any other questions so far? So let's be interactive. I know it's close to lunchtime. I stand between you and lunch. So I'm just giving you a very quick, simplified view of the process. But it can be quite painful in the beginning, especially when you try to collect data and make sure the data is there and so on. And then you can test the model and implement. So testing the model and so on, because we are not an expert, right? In flood or air or whatever. So we have to show the results to the client, and what they do is that they will see whether what we are doing is right in terms of the output. So the person who's going to interpret results are basically the subject matter experts. Okay, so usually we sit with them and discuss. So this is what exactly my team is doing this morning in Putrajaya. What we then do is deploy. So the deployment and operations part comes next. Okay, so scalability and so on. Okay, so this is a very simplified view. So I'm not sure what is your background. I know this is FCM, so most of you are creative guys. And what you want to do is actually how to make use of available tools to create values and also to create applications and so on. So what I want to go through now is, so I have to answer this question, otherwise Dr. Ku will say, I'm not doing my job. So here is, so the question is, where are the research gaps? So I'm not going to talk, I'm not going to show you where the fundamental research are taking place, but again, I've just taken this excerpt from the IEEE DSAA. Actually, DSAA is the IEEE Conference on Data Science and Advanced Analytics, so this is the call for papers, part of it, from 2016. So you can see, especially large-scale applications. So I guess most of us here are interested in applications. Where can you apply it in which domain? So number one is online social living environmental data analysis. Okay. Mobile analytics for handheld devices, large-scale recommender systems. I'll show you a recommender system later on, or what it looks like. Cognitive systems, end user analytics, business, government analytics is very interesting. Telecom, national security. So just let me share, I think just 6 months ago I met a vendor, it's an Indonesian vendor, that actually does social media sentiment. So what they have done is they have collected data in Malaysia, Singapore, ASEAN and wherever for the past 20 years. And when we sit down with them, because that time was, it was just before the Sarawak state election. Okay, so I think you know which time is that. So this vendor actually came and presented to our police. This is our solution. So what does the solution? What the solution does is that it can, it has enough data to actually show you what is the communication strategy of opposition and what is the communication strategy of government. Exactly, it can tell you. Okay, if there are certain topics, what is the usually how the opposition actually approach it. Okay, so it's that powerful, and we saw it, and it's quite very impressive. Okay, but this is only based on data which is available on the newspaper, online blogs, and so on. So, and this is some of the other interesting bit that some of the cities are doing. This is the city of London. You can go live. I'm not going to go live here. You just go to citydashboard.org. This dashboard is actually created by UC College London, and I believe it's hosted there also. So if you go to London, so the primary transport in London is basically the tube, right? Or you take the bus. If you're rich, you take the black cab. And what it does is actually that, so the city dashboard actually depends on IoT data from all the sensors planted across London. it's easy to do this because all the most of the facilities are under Transport for London, TfL, under the mayor's office. So you can see that the tube lines, these are all the tube lines, so we can tell you before you step out and go take to the tube what is the service status so you don't get caught. To avoid things like what happens in our LRT, sometimes you get stopped, you need to walk on the tunnel and so on. So in London also you have a lot of bicycle for hires, so people take bicycle to go for lunch. You can actually, based on the sensor data, it can actually tell you at which point, what is the demand and which are the empty bike slots. London buses. Now what is not shown here, if you go to the website, citydashboard.org, right at the bottom there, it tells you how are the folks in London feeling at any particular time. Are they happy? Are they happier than the average of the country or so on? Of course, they have some method to actually do that, so it's quite interesting. And if you go to the Rail webpage on the right-hand side bottom, it also shows you some Twitter feeds. What are London people tweeting about? So after a Premier League match, for example, involving Arsenal and whatever club, you can see, that people are tweeting about that, people are talking about that. Okay, so these are some of the things. Is it easy to do? Of course, dashboard here is easy to do, but curating the data from behind is not easy to do, and possibly this can be some of the projects that some of the students can actually take up. And it also has some real-time traffic cams across London, and also the weather and so on, and air pollution. Okay, so these are some of the interesting bit which is happening elsewhere, which we don't see here, but I think our government is picking up really quickly. Okay, what's next? No questions so far. Okay, so here, let's go to the more interesting bit. I don't know who plays this game, I don't play. This is a Battlestar Galactica online game. Anybody plays online game? See, sometimes I don't play this game, because I don't want to get hooked into games and so on. But sometimes we have to play just to feel what is it, how they use technology, right? So what happens in this game is actually, as with many games, so a lot of games you cannot play offline, right? It requires you to be online for various reasons. So what it does is actually it sends your data real time back to the server or the edge servers and so on. And what it does is that if you play strategy game or this kind of game, sometimes you get stuck, right? Sometimes you get stuck, you don't have enough money to buy another armor or missile and or plane and so on. So what it does is that it actually sends this data back to a central server, does some analytics there, and it can provide you real-time offer.
Yeah.
For 3 ringgit, 50 cents, maybe you get a missile. Just like last time you played Angry Bird,
yeah.
Right? If you get stuck 5 times, you cannot go through the level. Of course, you can play cheat. You can go YouTube and see how people solve it. Or you can spend 3 ringgit, 50 cents, buy a set of eagles and you know what's eagle, right? Some of you will actually play the game. The eagle can kill everything at the same time. Destroy all the pigs at the same time. Okay? So this is one of the, if you are involved in entertainment, the media and so on, so this is one of the things that people are doing now, especially for gaming. I don't watch this show and I don't play this game, I just put it here for example. Okay. Who plays this game? You don't have to show me your hands because your dean is not here. I think it's okay. You can maybe there's some Pokemons running around here. Who plays? I don't play it and I refuse to let my kids play it. Not serious player. But now I think also not, we don't hear much of it already. Who knows how to predict where or which kind of Pokemon will appear where? So some of the interesting bit that people are doing actually, I've got a demo. I have the data about 400 Pokemon sightings, which is in my machine, I'll show to you. You can know across the world and even in Malaysia which city is, the Pokemon appear the most and what time, at what time, what is the temperature at that time, and so on. So there's some pretty interesting work that you can actually do in these kind of things. Is actually to try to predict
where did Pokemon come? And if you're good at it, you can actually provide some service, put another app, you know, you sell it. If your prediction is true, you get 50 cents, and then you get, otherwise, you know, there's nothing to lose. Okay, so so let me show you this bit. Can't see clearly because I think the projector. So this is data of Pokemon sightings across the world, 400 records of them. I'm just zooming into one of the cities in Malaysia. I'm not going to ask you to guess because you can't see anything. This is the city of Kuching. Of course, I have the data from city of KL. So if you play Pokemon, so probably you know you want to have a look at this data, so you can actually see tiny numbers there. Numbers there are how many sightings in that particular latitude and longitude for that particular, and there's a time behind it. Okay, so this is if you want to predict it. So this is a spatial temporal prediction problem, just pretty much like the OPI I was talking about just now. In the month of August, there are about 2,200 Pokemon appearance in the city of Kuching. You can't see this, but. This is actually the Kuching, the Sarawak River up here. So this is actually the city center by the Sarawak River. If you have been to Sarawak, okay, so this is the city center, and there's obviously there's a bit quite far away here also. So right, so you can actually create, do some research, or create some product services around this kind of ideas. Now, can you take a guess? Because Pokemon appear, you know, at different times of day, right? So, most of them appear during what time?
Night time.
Okay, so let's see, right? Let's see. So to the students, you can ask yourself, what you know, if you get hold of this kind of data, what kind of research or what kind of product services can you do? Nearly 800 morning equally so. This is not the time. This is just a stacked bar chart. Evening, I don't know why evening so little. Right? Maybe you don't have time to play. You are driving back, and they don't want you to play while you are driving. So maybe evening also. Right? And the afternoon also. So more or less, you know, so you can do actually pretty quite a number of things with this kind of data. So there's actually a competition going on right now. Who can predict with certain amount of accuracy where these kind of creatures will appear and when? It's not as simple and straightforward, because in the data that you have, they have things like what is the time of day, what is the temperature, what is the air pressure. Yeah, so of course I do not know. I just quickly come up with this for this talk. You can have a look at it if you want. Okay, so there are many. I think there are many things that you can actually do. And if you go back to the Battlestar Galactica problem, who has used Amazon before? Who has bought something from Amazon? Most of us, right? So once you buy something, the next time, or even once you look at something, the next time when you come around in Amazon, it would suggest to you that, well, these are, you know, we like to suggest these kind of products to you. So this is actually some kind of recommender system behind, where it actually looks at who are the other users with similar features like you, of similar interests, what do they like, and they will suggest to you. Yeah. Recommending friends can be dangerous, or it can be quite interesting. Okay, so basically, I'm just giving you a tour of what can be done, or what is already done. So, you know, in entertainment, some of the works that we are doing with Telekom Malaysia, especially HIT TV, is actually to look
look at understanding the TV viewership. We're also doing things like fault prediction and so on. Sometimes your internet can jam up, doesn't work and so on, what happens and so on. So looking at that. Okay, I think that's about it. I'm quite happy to take some questions or anything. So based on what you see, you can actually think of the amount of... of course, people like us in computer science will do a different kind of research. In media, you probably want to do a different kind of research. And you can make some money for yourself also. If you go to the data science competition site Kaggle.com, if you're up to it, there are real cash, cold hard cash for you to win. Okay. Any questions, especially from the students? They need some incentive.
Graduate or postgraduate level?
We are starting in 2 weeks time.
Whoa. That's a specialization only or?
Specialization under computer science.
2 weeks time, eh?
Yes, certainly.
All right. We will welcome more questions because lunch will be served at 12:50, so we're running like ahead of time. So more questions please.
You have to get through me first before going to a lunch.
So the more questions you ask, the faster you can. Any question?
No question. Just one question.
Well, I want to know about, probably you have done some research in data science for university students, data in terms of education in higher level. I think typically MMU has that data. I do not know, probably you have done some analysis on that, whether that data can actually do some predictions towards the student results. Also maybe about their achievement in employment, things like that. Because being in higher education, I think we do have access to those data. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm going to answer your question in a different way. We have access to many kinds of data, but the question is that whether we have a governance process to govern the process of using the data or not. This is the key question. And if you don't have that, it cannot be free for all, right? I can do whatever I want with the data. Then I'm in trouble, right? Our university is in trouble. So I think that that process has to be... Of course, we have looked at a very small set of data. Okay, within faculty, it's okay. But university-wide, I think the governance process needs to be there first. At least the governance. So.
On the process part, maybe I'd like to make a remark.
Okay.
Okay. In concerning sharing data and all that, I have, as a faculty member in our faculty, that's provost faculty, right? I have to make special requests that I have access to just a little bit of information on the students I'm teaching.
So he's not complaining, but he's actually following up on my question on governance. So governance is important.
Right? I just need to know my students, I'm teaching, say, foundation students, I want to know, I teach mathematics, I want to know what kind of grades they get for the SPM mathematics. And I have to make special requests for it. It cannot even come to me automatically each semester I teach.
So the maturity level in Malaysia is that, you know, even in government, in private companies, many people do not know what data they have. You know, when they ask us, can you help us? Okay, you go and have a look, this is data, you go and have a look what's inside. Okay, so this is the reality of at least many organizations in Malaysia. Simply because many projects, if you go to banks, right, one of my friends recently joined Hong Leong as the CIO. So when he joined, you know, he said, how come? There are many silo databases here and there, simply because when they start up the project, it started up as a silo project. So each department will have their own project, they have their own data store, and so nobody actually really knows what the entire organization has. So that is actually one of the key issues I think we see in many of the organizations, are real issues. I believe MMU included.
All right. Any question?
All right. Let me ask a question then. For our next general elections, so you're talking about government and opposition, who do you predict will win and how much percent?
I don't do that thing. Let the professionals.
No one's done behind closed doors.
Yeah, simply because it's like predicting the stock market. I don't do that kind of work, but some of us like to predict stock market. So if stock market prediction is so well, you know, nobody actually will work, right? You only work on the stock market, nobody will actually these kind of things. So simply because there are many latent variables that you don't actually see happening behind.
Right, next question, please. Yeah.
I just wondering, because of data already, seems like a mountain. Maybe we have to acquire some kind of literacy. Maybe you can give a clue on this path towards understanding our own this data and make good use.
Yeah, we don't usually look at the data first, we look at what is the problem first. Because big data does not, if we have, you know, large volume data, does not mean data is useful.
Make it at a personal level that give a scenario that can help, like, for example, our daily life in that sense. Rather than the big skill for the company, for the problem, maybe can you illustrate more how that usage can apply to us?
So just to be interactive, I'm going to open up that question to everybody else. All of you use Facebook, social media, and
yeah.
So on.
Overwhelmed.
You want to help me, right? The news.
Media.
Yeah, make the question a bit clearer and Siva maybe can answer.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. It's about, I think, we personally want to apply data for usefulness, right? But maybe there's some kind of literacy. People talk about information literacy. How can it, you know, be used for us in a personal level, useful way that we can also apply it to make a good contribution. I would like to understand that part.
Okay, maybe I say as example and then I pass it on to Siva. I think he's also quite interested to say something. Okay, what I've personally experimented with is that all of us drive to work, right? I drive about 40, 45, 50 minutes each direction every day to work. So what I do is that, you have a smartphone, right? And a smartphone has a GPS. So what I do is that I download a GPS logger, I log my travel from my house to MMU doorstep. Yeah, so that means you have a sequence of GPS readings from your house to MMU or whatever. And you can do quite a number of things with that. You can analyze your own driving patterns, where you tend to fall asleep or whatever. Okay, and I think there's one local company who is actually using this technology. And they are using the technology that people have built into Pokemon Go. Because if you play Pokemon Go, if you jump a bit, there's a bit of jitter in your GPS reading. So what they have done is that this, I'm not going to mention the company, but the product is, they are doing this, where actually if you drive, you on your GPS logger, and if you hit a pothole, So they're going to be a bit of jitter. So with that, they can actually compile and look at where are the potholes and put that information to your local authority. And you know, instead of them serving, where are the potholes? So you can actually use that, your own personal data, to actually identify in certain, I don't know how they do it, but it could be possible. So there is a IoT company in Malaysia already starting to do this kind of work. So this is, if you want, I'm going to pass it to Dr. Wong and then come back to Siva.
Okay, I want to maybe make some comment about that. I think in the research community, it's kind of a global phenomenon. I think it's like, I read that a huge percentage of research, out there in the so-called publication, are actually, I think like something like 90% of the papers that are generated in this so-called academic work are read by the authors, the reviewers, and the journal editors, and nobody else. So I think there's a huge problem here. The thing is that I think, very frequent, you hear researchers say, okay, I know I'm expert in ABC, XYZ, and all those things. Okay, so they have these tools, then they're trying to look for a problem. So if your hammer is your only tools, everything to you is a nail. You see an egg, you knock at it, it breaks the egg, right? I think also along with what Mr. Siwa said just now, I think you look at the startup communities, I have attended some event at Magic, right? There is a lot of companies have a lot of problems to solve. They're looking for people to help them to solve. But then, from what I see, is that they try to approach the university. They have this problem. They talk to the university. Some people say, okay, I'm expert in X, Y, Z. But they cannot translate that. Okay, you have to start with a problem, and then you find a solution to it. It's kind of that's why people always say that the research in the academy sometimes is just quite irrelevant a lot of times. It's kind of global phenomenon. I think, that differentiate, let's say Silicon Valley, places like Stanford, MIT, their research are very industrial driven, and in fact, what they contribute in that.
Talk about data and usefulness. Two things I want to make. Number one, you got to make it simple for the user. Okay, so that they can, like what Facebook has done, right? From your posts, from your likes, it kind of profiles you. A lot of back engine analysis done upon you, and then you feel good when they suggest a friend to you or when they suggest a product to you, and it's something that resonates to you. In Malaysia, we have realized this, but the journey to train the back engine type people, the data scientists, the data professionals. I'm very happy to hear, that Prof. Ho has started this BDA course together with our sandbox, which is another way how the Asian Data Analytics Exchange, where people can come in who have some idea about what analytics can do and actually experiment and see that it works. That gives the interest in learning and people pursuing data science courses. We've done studies and, we need in 2020 to realize our vision of being a BDA hub for ASEAN, 2,000 data scientists and 20,000 data professionals. Data professionals are the cleansers, the people that do all the sort of, minute work, right? Today, I think data scientists, we have 100, 200 sort of things, so it's a huge, huge task ahead of us, but that's one area where we are going to be focused and pushing on. I'll just end with one thing. We talk about coding and all this, right? And Prof, with machine learning and how today you don't need to code. You just behave. You just, with sensors, with the way you react, you don't write algorithms to predict. From your behavior, algorithms are written, and then you already have coding, you already have predictions. So the nightmare scenario, and I'm going off topic here, going in the future, is that the most important trait for humanity, for us, is to retain our humanity. Because And when I speak to the young startups, they actually get this, you know. I thought all the young guys all just want to go and make money, be the next. No, they want to, as Dr. Wong was saying, they want to solve problems. They're very social conscious, and that's what gives me hope that the future, these guys will do the right thing. They want to, you know, solve traffic problems, they want to solve people, you know, the small carpenter who wants to get a job, they want to solve global warming, you know. So I'm very, very inspired with the Malaysian talent. And you know, while we start doing this at teaching at schools, you know, the work that my colleague Maria is doing, from, you know, getting university TVET graduates all ready for industry, and the stuff that, you know, MMU is doing, I really hope that, you know, we can collaborate closer more. You know, we will bring the startup community, we work together, ideate, start with some small projects, you know, and eventually let MMU be like, you know, the Cornell or the MIT examples that I showed earlier on. Right, so sort of rambling on a little bit, but you know, I think that, you know, we have to really take this seriously.
All right, awesome. Peter wants to say.